what you need. You keep on searching. Done all the work, but you keep on working. When you're running on empty, you can't find the remedy. It's come too well. Spend your whole life chasing what's missing. That empty inside just ain't gonna listen. Nothing can satisfy. When the world leaves you high and dry, just come to
slow getting in and out of the pulpit. I'm still trying to get my feet from underneath me, and I want to thank you for all of your prayers on my behalf. It's been quite a whirlwind. It still is emotionally and physically. I'm trying to get my mind wrapped around where I'm at, what happened, where I'm going. For those of you who are on Facebook, I'm so delighted that you guys have chosen to worship with us today. I do have to tell you guys this morning that I'm returning back to the book of Hebrews, and I'll probably... Well, not probably. This is probably, I need to quit saying probably, so I'll probably quit saying that. This is the hardest hitting passage in all the scriptures. It really is. And so it's a warning to the church, and that's one of the reasons I like to preach through books of the Bible, that I have to deal with everything as it comes along, and this is one of them that comes along. So there's two places I'd like for you to turn to, and that's Hebrews chapter 6, and then I'd also like you to turn to Isaiah chapter 5 in preparation for Jim's reading this morning. I had something else I wanted to say, but I can't think what it is. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we do love you this morning as we do every morning. Lord, with an inadequate love compared to the love that you have for us. Lord, from the moment that you called us, you have determined that you would preserve us and keep us and love us and never let anything pull us out of your hands. And Lord, what do we have to return in such a gracious gift that you've given us? Your grace is beyond measure. It's beyond emotional and mental understanding. You're altogether, as the song says, beautiful. Father, I pray this morning that as we come to you in the spirit of worship, Lord, that you would help us to elevate our voices and rejoice for what you've done for us. And Father, when we turn to your word, that we would carefully consider the words that are either read or the words that are spoken about where we stand before you, for you are a holy, holy, holy God, and you are almighty. And we pray this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning. Have you been enjoying the spring weather? Amen. We get it for a day or two and then it's gone, and we have some cold weather again, but during the spring weather, what have you been doing? Have you been outside to play a little bit? Yeah. And what were you playing? Was it fun? Okay. Well, you know what I was doing part of the time? I wanted to get some flowers planted. Now, it's too early to plant too many of them, because some of them won't survive when we get cold weather again this coming week. But there are certain ones that will. So I had to get ready to do that. And I brought one in to show you. This is one I want to get planted. I want to put this in my flower bed. And it should grow okay, I think. I have a problem with deer, but I don't think deer like plants that have a smell to them. So I'm hoping this one will survive. But I couldn't just plant it. I needed to get the ground ready. So to get the ground ready, I needed to do some work. I needed to get some tools out, because in the ground there were weeds. Now, I have a friend whose mother had a definition for weeds. It's not exactly a definition I use, but she said a weed is any plant that grows where you don't want it to be. I kind of like that definition, but it throws away some good plants. But look at that weed. That one wasn't hard to get out. I could basically go over and go, whoop, and it's out. But what happens if it grows for a while? Look at this plant. Look at those roots. They're getting longer and longer and longer, aren't they? And guess what would happen if it kept growing? It would get even longer, and that's why it was harder to get out. Did you know that we have sins that are kind of like weeds? First of all, do you remember what a sin is? A sin is something that God doesn't like. Something that we do or say, or something that we don't do that he wants us to do. Those are sins. And they have a tendency to grow if we don't stop them. I want to share something from the Bible with you. This comes from 1 John 1, verses 8 and 9. If we say we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves and refusing to accept the truth. But if we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us of every wrong. Now that's pretty good news. That's telling us that if we will tell God that we have done wrong, he forgives us. And we're not going to have to get the shovel or the spade or the axe or anything to dig out the weed of sin, because our confession does that for us when we tell God we have done something wrong. And that's pretty good news, isn't it? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for the blessings and the gifts that you have provided for us. We thank you for your redemption, for your love and your grace. Watch over these boys and girls. Protect them and their families. In the name of your son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. And now it's time to go down for Children's Church.
Also, two new women's Bible studies are starting up. They're starting in May,
So check your bulletin for the details on that and sign up so that we can get a handle on who's coming when and all that for the people that are helping drive that forward. But get excited about participating in the Bible studies. And then also, just to, in case you didn't see the slide earlier, the father-child birdhouse project that was supposed to be this coming Saturday has gotten pushed back to June 4th, so just got postponed. We're still going to do it together.
This is a thank you letter from the Hope Center in Hagerstown, where they help homeless men and families get back on their feet. We made a donation to them, and they wrote us a very nice thank you letter for that. It says, on behalf of the board of directors, staff, and those we serve, we want to thank you for your generous donation for our kitchen renovation and expansion project. Your gift is greatly appreciated. It is a privilege to work together with Pleasant Valley Baptist Church to be a blessing to those who have so little and hurt so much. Your support of this project has certainly blessed the lives of men, women, boys, and girls as they enjoy the meals in our new facilities. We have received your gift of $2,000 on February 22nd. Thank you. Your gift may make all the difference in the life of someone who comes to the Hope Center for a meal and finds the answer to their greatest need, a relationship with Jesus Christ. Signed, Bruce L. Sunny Shank. He's the director up there. It's dated March 8th of 2022. Yes?
Explain to the congregation how they gave the gift.
Okay. The way the gift was given, and, man, we're on Facebook, so this, I don't know. But anyway, it was money that was received because of a program that was out there, and we, rather than just putting that money into the general fund, we kind of set it aside for usage for special projects like this. So it was a blessing to be able to do that because of the monies that were made available to us. So it's been a real blessing.
In other words, at the business meeting, you guys voted to give this money whether you were there or not. That's what I was getting at.
Okay, all right. So when you see the business meetings, you're welcome to join us for that, especially if you're a member and help participate with that. Maggie has a VBS announcement.
Morning, everyone. If you look in your bulletin, you'll see this paper kind of outlining a few things about VBS, what we need. If you can donate, that'd be great. Also, there's going to be a meeting for all VBS workers this Wednesday at 6 p.m. If you're not able to make it, that's okay. I plan on sending out an email with minutes so everybody can stay in the loop. And we also need two volunteers to help out with the games. So if you're interested in any of this, you know, just find me and we can talk. Thanks.
Good morning. Today we will be reading out of the book of Isaiah, chapter 5, verses 1 through 6. And as soon as you find it, please stand if you're able. The vineyard of the Lord destroyed. Let me sing for my beloved, my love song concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it, and he hewed out a wine vat in it. He looked for it to yield grapes, but he yielded wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I have not done in it? When I looked for it to yield grapes, why did it yield white grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make make it a waste, and that it should not be pruned or hoed. And briars and thorns shall grow up. I will command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. And this is God's holy word. Please remain standing.
Our next song is Waymaker, and the first song is kind of a prayer and asking God to take my life, conform it, take my mind. It's our mind, body, and soul that we're giving it up to God. And when we invite Him in like that to move among us as we gather as Him, He truly comes among us, and He is the one that makes the way. It's through no doing of our own. It's what He does. Let's join in song.
Sinners plunge.
Whether we are found to be in faith. That will let us know. And I forgot something that I wished I hadn't. First of all, I want to thank all the people that were involved in the play, and I know that was an awful lot, or whatever you want to call it. It was absolutely wonderful. You guys had actually done the best out of any of them that have ever been done. You really did. You did a superb job. I watched it online at home. And Brother Talon, I think that I might put him up for an Oscar or an Academy. I don't know what the awards were. I think he did an excellent job, a particularly excellent job. Although theologically, I think that his part might be askewed a little bit. We might deal with that a little bit this morning. I have no idea. Secondly, I want to thank those who made it. The church moved seamlessly without me being there. Somebody came to me and asked me, well, aren't you a little nervous that the church kind of went on without a hiccup? And I'm like, that is a testimony to actually leaving something that will actually operate rather than just flounder and fall off. I was excited. I was like, man, I might be able to be gone for 6 or 8 months. Nobody even know, as long as the paycheck kept coming in there, I'd be fine with that. So let's turn to the book at hand, the chapter, Hebrews chapter 6. If I'm going to deal with, I start to use the word probably again. If I'm going to deal with the hardest text in the Bible, you can imagine that it probably won't go. Actually, I'm in the pulpit pretty early, so we probably will finish up on time. So let's read our text, and I have a little bit of an intro that I want to come in with this text, and then we'll begin unfolding the text. And the writer says, therefore, let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go into maturity, not laying again the foundations of repentance from dead works and faith towards God, and of instructions about washing and laying on the hands, the resurrection of the dead and eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. For it is impossible to restore again to repentance those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have shared in the Holy Spirit, and have tasted the goodness of the Word of God and the power of the age to come. If they then fall away, since they are crucifying once again the Son of God to their own harm and holding him up to contempt. For the land has drunk the rain that often falls on it and produces a crop useful to those whose sake it is cultivated and receives a blessing from God. But if it bears thorns and thistles, it is worthless and near to being cursed, and its end it is to be burned. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are talking about a passage that has both blessings and cursings. We also have a passage that talks about something that is impossible. Impossible to restore to repentance those who have once been enlightened and tasted the heavenly gifts and understand the things about the Holy Spirit. Father, help us to better understand this particular passage. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God has always helped me in my time in need in the pulpit, whether I've been sick or not feeling well or whatever the case. He's always come through, and I suspect that he'll come through again today. Although I am a little warm. Are y'all warm in here? Raise your hand if you're warm. Okay, then it's primarily me and not the condition. May has always been a busy month for me, and not just busy because of spring. It's always been a particularly busy month for me. Sherry and I, we got our first house in May. In order to be able to get the particular loan that we had to do a lot of preparation for that particular house. And it was exhausting in order to get to that, to run a full-time business, to run from Germantown, to run to Woodbine, to work late at nights in order to get that done, then go to closing, then get everything loaded up, get it in there, get it in the house. It was an extremely exhausting month. And then a few years later, come May, I'd received the calling to go into the ministry in order to get the house ready for sale. It was another exhausting May to get through there like a whirlwind, to get everything ready so that it could actually go to sale, get on the market, so that I could be in Louisville, Kentucky at my first class August 29th. You might think May to August is a lot of time, but it's not when you got a whole lot of things going on. And May of 2003 was particularly heavy work for me, particularly busy time of the month. I graduated Bible college. My daughter graduated from her college. My other daughter graduated from high school. And so one daughter is getting out of college. One daughter is getting started college. I had been called to a particular church, which meant that I had to leave Fern Creek, Kentucky to go over to Cleves, Ohio. I've also been ordained that month, which also meant that I had to go to Woodbine, Maryland to the Calling Church in order to get ordained and move all this stuff all around. It was an exhausting month, and so you might ask, where am I going with all this? Here's the bottom line. As I was going through, let me back up just one more moment. As I'm moving into my new church, I could tell that in two offices that had been neglected for decades. I could tell by an inch of dust that was on everything that was in there. And so I'm moving my stuff into that office, trying to settle in, excited about the new ministry opportunity that God's provided me. And as I'm moving things around, I notice over in the office that where I was moving things to that I wasn't going to be part of, they had a baptismal membership book. And so I became intrigued with it, and I opened it up, and I started flipping through it. And as I was flipping through it, it was pages after pages after pages after pages in just a few years period, like over a 10-year course of period. There was 200 people or more that had been baptized and became members of that church. And here's the striking thing. When I got there, the church was running in attendance of about 25 on Sunday mornings. And so I wondered about that particular church. I'm thinking to myself, the last two pastors, one on Singleton, one Pendergrass. I'm like, these guys, and please forgive me, those of you on Facebook as well, I'm not trying to down anybody, but I surmise that these two guys must have been about nickels and noses. The only thing that they wanted to do is they wanted to baptize people so that they could report on the ACPs that I baptized 50 or 75 people that particular year. And I vowed that that would never happen to me, that I wouldn't baptize people and then people just disappear and you'd never see them again. But unfortunately, that has happened to me as well. I have baptized people in this church that I have baptized and never seen after baptism. I've baptized people in this church that I have spent time at their home, sat down with them, explained to them what does it mean to be a Christian, and then all of a sudden they just disappear. So where am I going with all this, and what's the bottom line? Well, most of us have seen people who have come to faith in the Lord. We've seen them come in as a hot $50 car, and all of a sudden you don't see them anymore. You've seen some people come in real low and slow in the faith, and then God doing a work in their lives, and then God building them up. And then you've seen people who God has built, or it seems that God has built up real quickly. They have been in all kinds of roles in the church, and then all of a sudden you never see them anymore. And I know even quite a few pastors that have came in, got a church, and then all of a sudden something happened to them and they have just disappeared. I remember one particular day that I was walking to Cleves, Ohio, and I did a lot of walking in Cleves, Ohio, and I knocked on the door, and this man, and he kind of looked like he was homeless. It's one of those houses that you walk up to where you got to kind of come in underneath all the weeds and stuff down the sidewalk. You know what I'm talking about? The house that you see alongside the road that you really can't see the house? And so I knock on the door, and the gentleman's there, and I'm saying, we got Vacation Bible School, and he's about 50 years of age, and he goes, I don't believe in any of that stuff. And I says, excuse me, why don't you believe any of that stuff? He says, I'm a graduate from Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. I was a pastor for 10 years. I don't believe in any of that stuff anymore. And he wouldn't even talk to me. And the reason I bring all that up is because the Bible here, what we're dealing with in this passage, is particularly clear about people who have fallen away, and says it is impossible again to restore them to repentance. And it's an actual warning. We're going to deal with that as we get to that particular passage. This passage begins with new converts are taught. They're taught the elementary things of Christ, and then it goes on to teach them elementary doctrines of the Bible, or elementary doctrines of God. And it's really good to have these elementary doctrines taught to you, because it gives you a good foundation upon which to grow. And these people experience all these things, and there's a fancy word for it, and it's called catechism. It's one of the things we don't do as well in the Baptist church, but they're taught these things. They know these things. In the first three verses, they're taught six things. Actually, seven, if you took a look at the very first one, and you turn back with me and look with it as we go through there. He says, let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ. That's the first thing that they're taught. He's not talking about leaving Christ. He's talking about leaving this concept that we have to be taught these things all over again. But here's the six that I want us to kind of concentrate on for a little while. He tells them that first, that they had been taught the repentance from dead works. They would understand that, you know, quit trying to earn your salvation. Stay away from those things, because salvation is a grace and work of Christ. It is a grace and work of God. Quit trying to adhere yourself to the law. Now look at what it says in verse 1. Therefore, let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go into maturity, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works. We need to leave those things. Repentance contains an element of faith. When he says leave the repentance from dead works, we not only leave what we have done that had done us no good whatsoever, but repentance is always two-part, because repentance means to turn. It's a word that means turn. Not only do you turn away from what you're doing, you need to turn towards faith in Christ or faith in God. That's the second thing that's built into this particular passage right here. Now, I know that I'm going to be giving you quite a bit, but you're going to have to hang on to it as we get to the end. This is one of the things that you're going to have to think through. Third, he tells us about the instructions about the washings. If you have the King James Version, it translates it the doctrine of baptism, which it's not, because it's not the word baptizo. It's not about baptism. It's about the ceremonial cleansing that the Jewish people used to do as they prepared themselves to worship God. And what we would come to know this as a sanctification, the process of cleaning ourselves up internally. And fourth, he tells us to move away from the doctrine of the laying on of the hands. The laying on the hands is the acknowledgement that you have been gifted for certain ministries, and it is a symbol of the empowerment of the Holy Spirit to be able to empower you to do the ministry that you've been called to do, whether it happens to be evangelism or teaching or service or administration. The fifth thing that he tells us in this particular passage is they've been taught about the resurrection of the dead, or the resurrection from the dead. And this is something that the Jewish people knew quite readily, because it's taught clearly throughout the Old Testament, but it culminates in the person of Jesus Christ. The Jews would have readily understood it, and they would have readily acknowledged it from the Old Testament scripture. And there's two places in the Old Testament scriptures where Elijah is used by God in order to resurrect two people at two different incidences. And the first is in 1 Kings chapter 17. Elijah prays and gives a boy back, and God gives a boy back his life. And in 2 Kings chapter 4, Elijah raises a woman's son to life. And the one that I really like is Elisha, Elijah's protege, the prophet that comes after him. Elisha dies and he is buried in a tomb. And there's a young man that they're wanting to give burial. And all of a sudden the enemy comes upon them. They have to take the body and they have to throw him in the tomb with Elisha. And all he does is touch the bones of Elisha and he springs to life. I mean, that's a kind of a wild resurrection there. But it's taught in the scriptures, because I'm going to read it to you right here. In 2 Kings chapter 13, 20-21, if you want to look that on your own. So Elisha died and they buried him. Now bands of Moabites used to invade the land in the spring of the year. And as the man was being buried, behold, the marauding band was seen, and the man was thrown into the grave of Elisha. And soon as the man touched the bones of Elisha, he revived and he stood to his seat, and people were scared. I added that part, but I know that happened. In the New Testament, the resurrection takes on massive significance because it culminates in the person of Jesus Christ. And we've got this group of people right here that says that they need to move on. It's not that these things are bad. They don't need to be taught the same things over and over again. It's time to move on. It's time to grow up. Some of them have become stillborn. Some of them have become stagnant. They are no longer growing in their faith. You just happen to be showing up. And the sixth and the last thing that's taught in this particular passage about the things that they need to move on from is the eternal judgment. And this is something that the Bible clearly teaches that all of us will experience one day. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians tells us that, "For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may receive what is due for him, what is done in the body for either good or evil." These are the basic elemental teachings of the new convert. It gives them a stable foundation upon which to grow. I think this is one of the reasons why I love to study Old Testament theology so much, is because it gives me a good foundation by which to grow, by which that I can understand the New Testament. Because what the writer of Hebrews is doing here is he's actually opening up the Old Testament, showing us how it applies to the New Testament. I need to move on from the ABCs of faith. I'm sorry for taking my glasses on and off. I'm one of those days again where I just can't find my glasses. If we never progress in our faith, we should drop everything and evaluate ourselves. That's the most important thing that you can do for eternity. How many people know that the world right now is kind of messed up? Have you looked at the news and saw what's happening over in Ukraine? Do you understand that Putin at any moment can launch a nuclear world that would destroy the entire earth 5 times over? And I'm going to tell you, if you hear it on the radio, the only thing that you can do is go outside and look at the sun. Don't put sunglasses on because it's going to be too quick for that. This is important. This is more important than world affairs, is for us to understand where we are at with Jesus Christ. Because if we aren't found on the outside of it, at the very final moment, it ain't going to make no difference. Because he says it is impossible again to restore to repentance those who have fallen away. Those who have experienced all these elemental things that the writer is talking about. All these things that they have seen. All these things that they have witnessed. All these things that they have been taught. And once they've been taught all that, to just turn around and walk out and not see them again whatsoever, it's impossible to restore them to repentance. And so when you drop down to verses 4 to 6, and this is why this is called no second Genesis. Genesis means beginning. There are no new beginnings. There are no mulligans. There are no second chances when it comes to this. So let's read again verses 4, 5, and 6. And I think that it would be helpful if you do like I do, is to underline certain words in the Bible or certain phrases. And I've underlined, for it is impossible, because when God says something's impossible, I don't think that there's anything that we can do about it. For it is impossible in the case of those who've once been enlightened, those who have tasted the heavenly gift, those who have shared in the Holy Spirit. They have tasted the goodness of the Word of God, the powers of the age to come, and they have fallen away, to restore them again to repentance, since they are crucified again the Son of God to their own harm and hold him up to contempt. Don't tell my wife I'm getting excited, because so she's going to tell me when I get home and I collapse in the chair, you overdid it this morning, didn't you? I am excited about this passage. I really am. Because it's a heavy-hitting passage. It's the heaviest-hitting one in all of Scriptures. And so let's look at, why does he say it is impossible? Or, well, before we do that, let's look at three possible ways to understand this passage. Baptists have this saying, once saved, always saved. I hate that. I believe the doctrine, but I hate that statement. So there's three ways to look at this. If we can't fall away, this passage here is hypothetical. The writer's talking about something that could never happen. He's just using a hypothetical kind of in order to scare the people into alignment. And I don't think that the Bible necessarily does that. And the obvious problem with this view is if this sin cannot be committed, it is absurd to even bring it up in the first place. It's not hypothetical. Okay, the second view is that this could be actual. Some believe that God provides the grace by which it starts our faith. We come to him by faith, and then we need to have our faith cooperate with his faith in order to ensure our salvation so that we'll never fall away. I don't believe that, because the Bible speaks so plainly about the perseverance of the saints, or that we are once saved, always saved, but I don't like that phrase. The third view that I hold to is that this is an apparent, which means this is the way that we see it. When we've seen Uncle Bob or Aunt Sue or our best friend Joey or our sister Linda or whoever the case may be, who have participated in the life of the church, they have seemingly experienced the goodness of God, they have become baptized, they have made a profession of faith, and then they've walked away. We look at it and we say, well, they were a believer and they walked away, then apparently they lost their salvation. That's just apparent. I say that they were just experiencing some sense of euphoria. They've had some kind of movement, but it wasn't a spiritual movement. They have been elated. And, you know, one of the things about new Christians, and I experienced it, is that when you are starting to come to church and you are getting closer to the congregation, people get excited about new Christians. You know, it makes you feel good when you have people coming up to you and saying, "Oh, Brother Clayton, it is really nice to see you again today. Oh, you sound so wonderful. Oh, you're dressing real nice. Oh, would you like to participate?" And you start getting that attention. You're like, "Oh, wow, I kind of like this." But if the conversion's not real, what happens? You get bored. You take up the collection. There's no big deal. Greeter at the door's no big deal. Go cut the grass, no big deal. Being part of the treasurer or the trustees is no big deal. Yeah, go hunting, go fishing, just going out, going my merry way. Do you see how a person could be deluded into thinking that they're saved when they're genuinely not saved at all, because the people have showered affections on them? They actually like the things that are happening, and then all of a sudden they get bored with it. You can't get bored with Jesus. Can you? I ain't never been bored with him. I've asked him not to look at me a couple of times, but I've never been bored with Jesus. Have I been disappointed with brothers and sisters? Maybe once or twice. So this is not hypothetical, because it would do no good in order to bring up a hypothetical situation. It would actually be absurd to say, "Oh, this can't really happen to you, but you need to kind of watch out for it." That's crazy. And it's not actual, because the Bible teaches clearly that we can't be snatched out of Jesus' hand. I believe that. Not only do I believe that because I feel that, I believe that because the Word tells me that. So it has to be apparent. It has to be the way that we see things. That's what it's explaining. So let me give you three reasons, and I cut it back. I cut it way back. But let me give you three reasons why I'm telling you, why I believe, or that the Bible teaches, that this is apparent and not actual, because of the overwhelming preponderance of the evidence of the Scriptures say that we cannot fall away, and that we could never, ever lose our salvation. I'm going to ask you a question. The Scripture said that God began a good work in us. What happens? What happens? He who began a good work in us will what? See it to completion. Did he say that he's going to see it to completion if your will aligns with his will? Scripture asserts in Romans 8:28, he says, "For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height or depths, nor anything else in all of creation will separate us from what? The love of God in Christ Jesus." God's purpose for us will not thin out, and it won't run out. In Hebrews 8:29-30, it says, "For those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that they might become the first fruit among many brothers. And those who he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also what? Glorified." You, God's got you. He ain't letting you go. His Son died in order to keep you in his grips. And his Son's sacrifice was sufficient to pay for our sins. Scripture tells us that we are being kept by the power of God for an incorruptible, eternal inheritance that can never rust or decay. Listen to Peter. He said, "Blessed be the God of our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfaded, kept in heaven for you. What, in case you make it there? My gift's there. It's there. Who by the power of God are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last day. Ephesians 4:30 says that we are sealed. Who can undo the king's seal? Nobody. 1 John teaches that the apostates were never really true what? Believers. Though they were part of us, they went away from us, they never really were part of us to begin with. See, this is the preponderance of the evidence that Scripture teaches about the perseverance of the saints. And Jesus promises that if we come to Him, we'll have eternal life. Isn't that what He said? If you come to Me, I'll give you eternal life. He didn't say, if you come to Me, I'll give you eternal life, and if you mess it up, I'm going to snatch it away from you. What kind of eternal life is that in order to profess Jesus as Lord and Savior? And Jesus said that it's impossible to lead away the elect. Jesus assures us that for this is the will of My Father, that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in Him should have eternal life, and I will raise him on the last day. Jesus said that My sheep know Me, they hear My voice, they follow Me, and that no one can snatch them out of My hands. And I can go on and on and on and on. The people that Hebrews is speaking about are those who have fallen away, who were apparent Christians with apparent conversions, with apparent faith, who were never really part of the covenant community. Those who fell away have tasted the Word of God and they enjoyed it. Look right back with me in verse 5. What do you mean that they've tasted the Word of God and they enjoyed it? You know, there's people, non-believers, that love to hear sometimes the Bible being preached. Thomas Paine, back during the days of George Whitefield, back in the 1700s during the Great Awakening, George Paine, anytime that George Whitefield used to preach, Thomas Paine would show up and listen to him, and the people would say, Thomas, you don't believe in Christ. Why in the world would you like to show up and listen to George Whitefield preach? He says, you don't believe any of that stuff. He goes, no, but he does. He was dynamic. He enjoyed to hear the preaching of it. We also see that in the Scriptures as well. In Mark chapter 6, King Herod loved to hear the Word of God being preached by John the Baptist. Now listen to what it says. Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he kept him safe. When he heard, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he heard him gladly. Even the man responsible for his murder enjoyed hearing that. He tasted the Word of God. I was thinking of another incident. Should have wrote it down there, but I didn't write it down there. Didn't write it down in my notes. Oh, yeah, the Apostle Paul with King Agrippa. As the Apostle Paul stood before King Agrippa, and the Apostle Paul asked Agrippa if he wanted to be saved, because Agrippa was listening so attentively to the Apostle Paul as he's preaching. And King Agrippa says, do you think that I'd be so easily converted? He enjoyed listening to the Apostle Paul. He was at the point of conversion, but he just wouldn't step over the line. They tasted the Word of God and they enjoyed it. It's possible for people to see all kinds of miracles and still fall away. You know that? I mean, how many people have told you, if I just see a miracle, I'd believe? Or if Jesus would just come here and show Himself to me, I'd believe. Or if God would do a miracle through me, then my friends would believe. You know what? Jesus fed 5,000 people, and how many people stuck around after He got done feeding them? He almost lost all of his disciples, didn't he? He says, you going to leave with the rest of them? Where are we going to go, Jesus? Only you got the word of life. They witnessed Lazarus being raised to life. They saw the lame walk. They saw the deaf hear. They heard the mute talk. They saw the lepers cleansed. And they saw miracle after miracle after miracle. And when it came time for Jesus' crucifixion, what happened to all of them? They all scattered. Miracles aren't what get people saved. It is the conversion of the soul that gets an individual saved. And Jesus even said, can you look the part? Jesus even said that you can look the part, but yet you don't have any part in him whatsoever. Matthew 7:21 says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. On that day, many of you will say, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? Did we not cast out demons in your name? Did we not do miracles in your name? Did we not do mighty works and miracles in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. So it's possible to taste the heavenly gift, to be part of it, to witness miracles, and yet fall away. And when you do that, that's unpardonable. That's the horror of the warning that comes in the first three words of verse 4. It is impossible. And so if he says it's impossible, we got to ask ourselves, why is it impossible? Why is it impossible for these people to be restored again to repentance? And the answer is because they've committed the unpardonable sin. In Matthew chapter 12, when Jesus was cleansing the boy of a demon, and the Pharisees actually saw a miracle taking place, what did they do to Jesus, or what did they say about Jesus? When Jesus had committed this miracle, they attributed the work that Jesus did to the devil. They denied that the Holy Spirit was actually doing the work. They attributed the work to Jesus, to the devil. These people in this particular passage, they might not be saying the devil did it, but they're committing the unpardonable sin, but not attributing the things that they have saw and they've witnessed to the Holy Spirit. In that particular passage with Jesus, it says, whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. Therefore, I tell you, every sin and blaspheme will be forgiven people, but the blaspheme against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. And whoever speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or in the age to come. Jesus says the same exact thing that is said in this passage here in Hebrews. The Holy Spirit does something, we don't see it, we don't acknowledge it, we ignore it. That is blaspheme of the Holy Spirit. The Pharisees, they had been taught the elementary things. They had been enlightened by the miracles that they witnessed. They were partakers in the divine act of the Holy Spirit. They have tasted the goodness of the Word of God, but instead of praising God through Christ, they denied what they had actually experienced. They denied the Holy Spirit. They committed the unpardonable sin. This is the type of people who fall away. This is what happens when people in our churches decide that all of a sudden this doesn't make any difference to me. I don't even care about this stuff anymore. They deny the reality of the Holy Spirit working among the congregation as we watch people that are baptized because they've actually been saved. You know what? That's a big miracle. It's a big miracle that we've got a mighty God who will forgive us for all of our sins. And then to just turn around and walk out of the doors of the church and say, I don't really care about that stuff anymore. That is blaspheme of the Holy Spirit. They just grab their marbles and they go home. The Apostle Peter tells us likewise in 2 Peter 2:24, if after they have escaped the defilements of this world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the last state has become worse for them than the first, for it would have been better for them to have never have known the righteousness than after knowing it to turn back from the holy commandment delivered to them. What the true proverb says has happened to them, the dog returns to its own vomit, and the sow, after washing herself, returns to wallow in the mire, saying that they're not really real in the first place. There could be hardly a greater warning for people in the church who have been taught, who have been baptized, who have participated in the communion, watched as the Spirit of God calls people to repentance and to find out that they aren't true believers in the first place, because there's nowhere else to go. That's hard, isn't it? I mean, can I get a show of hands and say that this has been a hard sermon? A hard sermon? It is. It's hard on me. But you know what? It's not all doom and gloom. There's a light that shines through this particular passage. So I think that there's a word in order for those who think that they might have committed the unpardonable sin. Here's the test for that. If you're actually considering it, you've not committed it. You know what I'm saying? Have I been there? No, because you're worried about Christ. You're worried about your relationship to Christ. Those people who aren't really part of Christ or so easily walk out, they're not worried about it in the first place. So it's not all doom and gloom, but here's at the very end of it, verses 7 and 8, there is a warning and a hope both connected together, and the writer ends with hope. For listen, for the land has drunk the rain that falls upon it and produces a crop useful to those for whose sake it is cultivated, receives a blessing. What does he mean by that? God reigns on the just and the unjust. God's got a common grace that goes upon all people, but for those it takes direct effect into, they're the ones that actually produce this fruit that show that they have the righteousness of God. So there's hope that if he rains down upon you, that you produce righteousness, you belong to him. In verse 8, but if it bears thorns and thistles, it is worthless and near to being cursed, and its end is to be burned up. And I'm going to end with this fairly quickly, Talon, just to let you know. How can I tell where I stand in relationship to this passage? Two things. Firstly, if you're concerned about it, that is a good indication that you're not there. Secondly, and probably most importantly, is if you are further along than you were last year, if you have matured and moved on and don't need to be taught the same thing over and over and over again, because our faith isn't stagnant. It's meant for us to grow. It's meant for us to get involved into something. I'm not even appealing for you to get involved in church. Don't even take it that way. Matter of fact, if you think because I preached this, unless the Holy Spirit's clear, comes knocking on your door this evening, I don't even want you to volunteer for anything next week. But if you've not progressed and you're at the exact same place that you were last year, you're in danger. Faith is meant to grow. Growing things are healthy. Things that do not grow are not healthy and are in danger of dying. So I'm going to ask Town to play us a song of invitation this morning. And I pray that you would contemplate your relationship to Christ, you growing in him. And for those who have walked away, you know what? They might not be the type of person that have heard all these things. It might not be the person that this particular passage is talking about, although it could be. I don't know. Maybe you got a daughter, or you got a son, or you got a brother, or you got a sister, or you got a next-door neighbor, and they kind of had some kind of affections towards Christ, but they just kind of disappeared. Pray for them. Not only pray for them, go talk to them. And say, where are you at? I do that, but I'm not mean-spirited about it. How do you know Jesus? I don't ask them if they're saved. They'll tell you, I'm saved. How do you know Jesus? You know what? When you ask somebody that question, they got to tell you how they know Jesus. So come this morning, Brother Town plays us a song of invitation.
Please stand if you're able.
I hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus made it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. For now indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Let us pray. Lord God, our Father, we just thank you so much. You called us to be yours, and you hold us in your hand. You gave us to Jesus, that we would forever have a relationship with you. We just pray that as we think about those in our lives that maybe have heard the word but not really responded, just pray that we would have the wisdom and the wherewithal to daily pray without ceasing for their salvation, that they may be able to have the joy and the peace and the happiness, the patience that is only available through the power of the Spirit. And Father, we just know that as we come to you each day in prayer, that you are faithful to respond. Whatever it's in your will, you will do. Father, we thank you so much for bringing us together to worship and praise, that we would be able to go out into this world and be renewed to love you, that would be visible to others. We thank you for all you do for us. Bring us back together again, that we'd be able to lift our hearts and praise to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our closing chorus will be the first chorus of There Is a Fountain.
Wash all my sins away, wash all my sins away, and there may I, though vile as he, wash all